Hello. Hey everyone, my name is Rushi. Good to see y'all, thanks for coming out. Hi Becky, I haven't seen you in a long time. We're really excited to have Hiromi Goto here. A number of us just finished reading her book, The Chorus of Mushrooms, and it's amazing, so really excited to get to hear her read from whatever she's gonna read from tonight. Before that though, first thing, please silence your cell phones. Make sure those are all turned off so we can have a really smooth reading here. And second of all, and most importantly, I'm going to welcome up Ilana Friedland, your friend and a great poet, to open us up for the night. So give a round of applause for Ilana.
Hi. Thank you, Rushi. I'm going to read two things, a short thing and a long thing. And the first thing, is this good volume-wise? Excellent, thank you. First thing is about my mom. It's called, What to Say When the Bank Comes A-Calling. This poem is too small. I will live in my car if I have to. I will live in my yard, and I won't evict a single book. I will build a home of hardcovers. I will say, here I will sleep, and here I will cook. 1,000 golden spines surrounding me. I need only hands piling tiger onto apple, onto goat, and a host of bears and a bedroom. Listen, this is the house I have. The next piece is called I Collect the Children That Are Not Mine. In addition to teaching and taking classes here at CU, I also work as the assistant director of a religious school at a synagogue in Boulder. So this is about doing that work in the year 2017. So, Aviva is newly 5 years old. She is one whole hand and tells this to anyone who will listen. A man lives in a house. Aviva's babies have magic. She gets her own magic powers from her dolly and her stuffy. The powers are thunder and lightning and never getting dizzy. I run in circles to push her on the tire swing. More, she says, more. A man gets his powers from another country. They creep in through a series of cables deep in the ocean that winked shore before disappearing. Today at JCC preschool, Aviva had raspberries. Today after school, we are painting Tzedakah boxes. Juice from the raspberries covered her hands and face. Now purple paint has taken its place. A white man lives in a house. We walk together to the bathroom as she grasps my pinky finger. Her sister would not come with her. I have bad dreams if I do or do not sleep. A robotic voice calls. The purple paint looks like raspberries, and a white man lives in a white house. She steps atop the bathroom stool and cannot reach the soap herself. A white man with a bad plan. I let the soap pool in my palm and she reaches in. A bad man with a bad plan. She insists on turning the knobs and grabbing all the paper towel herself. A white man grasps a white house. I dream. A robot reaches 17 JCCs across the country. We resume our crafts as if nothing has happened. Soon, Captain Gabby asks for more paper and pencils. She darts ahead while Aviva and I walk. Aviva notices a missed piece of paint atop her pointer. It's like nail polish, she says. Yes, I say, just like nail polish. I hope she will remain. Captain Gabby hides beneath the table. I can do it, Aviva says. She takes herself to the faucet, and I run to the closet. Find the pencils. A robotic voice calls in to issue instructions. The lights are off and I cannot find the pencils or the drawing pad. I have 10 seconds. It is January 31st, 2017. It is a Tuesday and the JCC preschool is evacuated. The tape message comes at 11 a.m. I complete the bomb threat checklist. In the dream, there is a boat on the ocean and the boat is leaking. Through the seams creep children. A plastic device lives inside me. I lie prone to plug holes. The children keep coming. Jude has split his forehead open on the bow. Captain Gabby hides beneath a table, and Aviva goes to the bathroom by herself. Find the pencils. The children are leaking. Seams caulked with clothing, I stay prone. 17 bomb threats. Jude plows headfirst to aft. Find the drawing pad. A toe here. Here, a finger, arm, leg, stomach, until all that is left is my head. The robotic voice says it is too late. Captain Gabby beneath the table, and the sound of Aviva flushing the toilet with the door wide open. The plastic tip goes where it should not go, top of my cervix to spasms, and if I had already had kids, I would not be feeling like this. I dream I take the medication. I collect the children that are not mine. I keep them from a bad plan with a bad plan, but I can only keep mine. The air dries. We will breathe dust. Beneath the waves clinking like a thousand teacups, the cables whisper. Captain Gabby battle cries. I tell the children that if they hurry, there will still be time.
Thank you. And now to say a bit about the person you're all really here to see. Hiromi Goto is a Japanese-Canadian editor, fiction writer, cultural critic, arts advocate, youth organizer, and teacher of creative writing. But my favorite version of her bio opens with the following. Hiromi Goto used to be a horsey girl who never had a horse. Now she writes stories. She is not saying there is a correlation, but that doesn't mean one can't be found. This encapsulates the sense of humor and terrific strangeness found in Goto's works. She makes the everyday magical. When asked in another bio, where do you get your ideas? She responded, from snatches of conversation, a perfectly arched winter sky, shades of blue, the fertile ground between myth and dream, a childhood memory shaped, the sound of water, pain revisited, political beliefs, hope. And all of these can be found in her works that merge folklore with reality to tell stories of family, love, identity, and more. Goto's first novel, Chorus of Mushrooms, published in 1994, received the Commonwealth Writers' Prize for Best First Book in the Caribbean and Canada region, and was co-winner of the Canada-Japan Book Award. Her second novel, The Kappa Child, published in 2001, was a finalist for the Commonwealth Writers' Prize for Best Regional Book, and was awarded the James Tiptree Jr. Memorial Award. Her first children's novel, The Water of Possibility, was also published that year. Hopeful Monsters, a collection of short stories, was released in 2004. Her YA novel, Half World, published in 2009, was longlisted for the Impact Dublin Literary Award and received the 2010 Sunburst Award and the Carl Brandon Society Parallax Award. She's also written a long poem as well as a full-length collection of poems. And I am super psyched for her first graphic novel, Shadow Life, which is slated for 2018 publication by First Second Press. And if you need a taste of her work by Goto before 2018 that wonderfully combines images and words, make sure you check out her Twitter. Recent highlights include a picture taken of a snowy street framed by a window that is captioned, "A peculiar snow fell that morning, as if aliens had designed it to disperse the virus." I'm excited to experience her extraordinary storytelling in person. So without further ado, please welcome Hiromi Goto.
Thank you for that very kind and generous and welcoming introduction. It's a great honor to be here, my first time in Colorado, and I just love the sky and the prairies. A lot of my youth was in Blackfoot country in southern Alberta, Treaty 7 land, and it's the crisp night air, the brightness of the stars, and the whole expanse of mountain and prairie just kind of opens up the mind and heart, and you guys are so lucky to be writing here. I'd like to firstly acknowledge that I am currently reside in Coast Salish lands of the Squamish, Tsleil-Waututh, and the Stolo and Musqueam peoples. I live in a city called Vancouver, but the land we built the city upon is Coast Salish lands, and it's unceded territory. And I think it's so important for us settlers to acknowledge the peoples of the land. And it ain't us. Thank you, Marcia, for having me here. I'm going to be reading from Chorus of Mushrooms. It's my first book, and I actually started writing it, some of it, in my senior fiction writing class. Some of you are taking your courses now. And I was in my early mid-20s, and I took 3 one-year creative writing courses. And in my senior year, started what I thought was a collection of short stories. But the grandmother character, Naoe, was much larger than a short story could hold. She couldn't be held in a short story. She needed more room. And when I finished the third year fiction writing course, at the end of it, I had about 50 pages of a manuscript, unfinished. And that's where it all began. Naoe. Ah, this unrelenting dust-driven, crack your fingers dry wind has withered my wits, I'm certain. Endless as thought, as breath. Not much breath left in this set of bellows, but this wind just blows and blows and blows. Soon be blowing dust over my mummy carcass, and beetles won't find the tiniest bit of soft flesh to gnaw. Serves them right. Dust in my joints, dry as rust, and I creak. Well worn I am, well worked. Can't stoop to sweep up the dust swirling in the corners of the rooms. Dust swells and eddies, motes linger to parch my nose, my mouth. Don't bother dusting, I say. It'll come back surely. Let the paws of dust grow and mound, and I'll plant daikon and eggplant seeds. But let something grow from this daily curse. But no, Keiko just looks at me from the corners of her eyes. I know, never mind. No matter, just let Oba-chan sit in her chair in the hall so she can see who comes and goes, my back to the staircase, and I can see who comes through the front door. People have to pass me to get inside this house. Don't try to sneak by, I might stick out my foot. No one moves in this house without meeting my eyes, hearing my voice. Take no notice, I say. I'll try not to stare. I'll nod and smile. Welcome, welcome into this pit of dust, this bowl of heat. Ohaeri kudasai, dozo ohaeri kudasai. Talk loudly and enunciate. I might be stupid as well as deaf. They think a body can live in this country for 20 years and not learn the language. But let them think this. Let them think what they will, for they will. Sorry, Oba-chan no speak English. Maybe I'm the fool, but stubborn I am and will remain. Keiko glances at me these days, more often than before, with that curl of sour tofu curds lingering in her mouth. I'm not blind. I've heard the talk. I think we should start looking for an H-O-N-E, as if I can't spell. 85 years old and cast from my home. At least the dust here is familiar. Every grain, every mote, as familiar as the smell of my body. No time now to learn new dust in a new home. Let me just sit here. Let me sit here in the hall by the door. There are no windows here to torment me. I can only hear the muffled roar of the wind through the insulated walls, and I can drown out the incessant swirl of dust, of chaff, with words, little songs, and hum. I mutter and mutter, and no one to listen. I speak my words in Japanese, and my daughter will not hear them. The words that come from our ears, our mouths, they collide in the space between us. Oba-chan, please, I wish you would stop that. Is it too much to ask for some peace and quiet? You do this on purpose, don't you? Don't you? I just want some peace. Just stop. Please, just stop. Gomen nasai. Waru ne, oba-chan wa. Sorry, sorry. Keiko. There is method in my madness. I could stand on my head and quote Shakespeare until I had a nosebleed, but to no avail, no one hears my language. So I sit and say the words and will until the wind or I shall die. Someone, something must stand against this wind, and I will, I am. So, Japanese is dropped into this novel quite generously, as in the English language, as well as moving from using the English alphabet to phoneticize the Japanese language into actual Japanese hiragana and kanji, the characters. And I don't offer an index or glossary, and I don't offer sort of the in-house translation that you can often find in literary fiction, where the words are translated for you on the spot. So if you're reading a story and there's a quote-unquote foreign word introduced, then it would be something like, she raised the bowl of gohan, comma, rice, comma, to her lips. And for someone who's bilingual, then it's just redundant. She raised the bowl of rice to her lips. And it makes absolutely no sense. And it also centers the non-speaker. So I very much wanted to resist the idea of making foreign, quote-unquote, foreign languages accessible to the English reader. Because for me, I would often hear reviewers or reviewers talk about somebody's work, an international writer's book, whose story was so universal. And well, what makes a text universal? And one of it is the act of translation that's being done for the reader on the page. And I always thought of that as actually very misleading, because in real life, if you don't know the language, you don't know the language. だから私が急に日本語話したら何言ってるか全然わかんないでしょ。So this is real life, and so for me, it seemed like a more realistic treatment of language to keep it untranslated. But you know, this was in the early mid 90s. Now we have the interwebs and Google, you can look up anything. So I think it even more so now that it seems more realistic to me to have original language kept intact in the text. I'm gonna jump to a granddaughter section, Murasaki. So Murasaki does not speak Japanese. She can only speak English, and she feels a strong bond with Oba-chan, Naoe. Murasaki, the daughter of a 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 daughter. The list is endless, but I'm here. I turned my head slowly in Oba-chan's lap, the fabric scratched and stiff, inhaled dust and poetry. She stroked my forehead with her palm, and her words, they flowed fluid. I snuggled close and curled my legs and stopped pretending to understand. Only listened and listened. And then my mouth opened on its own accord and words fell from my tongue like treasure. I couldn't stop, didn't try to stop. They swirled, swelled, and eddied. The words swept outside to be tugged, tossed by the prairie's shaking wind. Like a chain of seeds, they lifted, scattered. Obachan and I, our voices lingered, reverberated off hollow walls and stretched across the land with streamers of silken thread. So Naoe leaves the mushroom farm after 20 years of living there and just disappears. So the family is left to deal with her absence. Munasaki. Local elderly woman disappears. Search continues. Late Tuesday night, the immigrant mother-in-law of local mushroom farmer Sam Tonkatsu went missing during blizzard-like snow conditions. We're very, very worried, says Sam's wife. We just want her to come home. Local RCMP and neighboring ranchers are combing the countryside, but weather conditions hinder their search. Cases like this are difficult, says Constable Martin. An elderly woman isn't likely to survive a single night during weather like we've been experiencing. What is surprising is that most town folk were unaware that the old woman was even living with the Tonkatsus. Foul play has been ruled out. What happened to your grandma? She went back to Japan. She got sick of all the snow and dust and up and left. I don't blame her. She went apeshit and was raving, frothing at the mouth, and she ran naked from the house, screaming like the pagan she was. What happened to your grandma? She started to grow fur all over her body, and at first we thought it was a symptom of illness or something, like she wasn't eating enough, so her body was compensating with fur to keep her warm. But we found out she was actually a tanuki, who had assumed the form of a woman so she could marry my grandfather because he had set her free from a trap, and she wanted to thank him by becoming his wife, but now she wanted to return to the wilds when she came. I found out then that everybody, including me, was always looking for a story. That the story could be anything, they would eat it. Mind you, the story can be anything, but there have to be details. People love details. The stranger, the more exotic, the better. Ooh, they say, ah. Nothing like a freak show to make you feel normal, safe by comparison. Tell us about the feet, they say. Did your grandmother have to bind her feet when she was little? Actually, feet were never bound in Japan, but someone keeps on perpetuating this. It always goes back to that, the binding of the feet, deformities, ritual hari-kari. Actually, it's haraki, but go on saying hari-kari for all I care. It's not about being bitter. You're invited somewhere to be a guest speaker, give a keynote address, whatever that is, everybody in suits and ties and designer dresses. You're the only colored person there who is not serving food. It's not about being bitter. You just notice. People talk race this, ethnic that. It's easy to be theoretical if the words are coming from a face that has little or no pigmentation. If your name is Hank and you have three blonde kids, no one will come up to you in the Safeway produce session, point at a vegetable and ask, what is that? I was standing in the ethnic Chinese rice noodles tofu patties exotic vegetable section of Safeway, fingering, squeezing, stroking Japanese eggplants for firmness, taut shining purple skin, and no rust spots. I love shopping, the touching of vegetables, lingering of fruits, and tapping my fingers on watermelon husks, just minding my business and choosing eggplants. What is that exactly? I've always wondered. I looked up from my reverie and a face peered down at me. A kindly face, an interested face. It's an eggplant. Oh, really? Surprise, wonder, joy. How wonderful! This is what our eggplants look like. They're so different. She held up the round, almost black, solid eggplant, bitter skin and all. She looked up at the handmade signs above the vegetables with the prices marked in dollars per pound. Lu bok, they read, bok choy, sui choy. What are they called in your language? I looked up at the signs. I don't speak Chinese, I said. Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry for what? I wondered. And there, right above the eggplants where all the other handwritten signs were, Japanese eggplants, $2.09 a pound. I took the long and graceful fruit I still held into my hand and smacked it smartly against the sign. Here, here it is, I said, and turned my back to examine hakusai leaves, sui choy in Chinese, according to the Safeway produce staff. Leave me in peace. Let a woman choose her vegetables in peace. Vegetable politics. Is that good enough for the reading? Should I read more? I can't see a clock.
You got plenty of time.
There's less of time. Yeah. Okay. An immigrant story with a happy ending. Mukashi, mukashi, oh mukashi. Nothing is impossible. Within reason, of course. Part 3. Everything that is missing or lost or caught between memory and make-believe or forgotten or hidden or sliced from the body like an unwanted tumor. Or a longing, a desire for. Forgetting or remembering something that never happened. Wondering when does one thing end and another begin? And if you can separate the two. Part 3, the missing part. When I was writing this novel, I came to the kind of an existentialist crisis at the end of part 2, when I came to realize that every time I wrote something down, then that narrowed the field of all possible stories. So that every moment of writing down the story closed off all the other things that could possibly happen. And then I found myself caught in kind of a philosophical existentialist trap of wondering if I was colonizing my own story. And it really, really tripped me up in weird ways. And so, which was actually good because it made me think about what are stories doing? And when this book is written, it was very much wanting to explore not just diversity, but diverse experiences under an identity such as Japanese Canadian, which is not a singular experience. So you have three generations of women, the grandmother, the mother, and the daughter, who experience being Japanese Canadian in different ways and respond to external forces, history, society, all those things in different kinds of ways. And so I was kind of caught in this conundrum of writing down what I was writing down meant that other forms of expressions of diverse Japanese Canadian experiences were not going to hit the page. Because when we're writing the story, there are constraints of story and also form. What kind of form are we writing in? Is it, you know, are you following the sort of the Freytag